Okay, so last time we were trying to understand how so we are actually realizing the double cover of the rotation group in four dimensions in terms of this SU to left and SU to right. So when you think about the Lorentz group in this way, the basic objects are spinors, so this is acted by SU to left, this is acted by SU to right, okay? And now, since we are constructing everything up from spinors, we want to try to identify a standard objects in space-time from the spinors, and then we saw that if you take the product of these two guys, so you have an object of the form V alpha beta dot, then this was actually corresponding to a vector, and this we saw it through this vector field. You can actually think about this in this way. Mu alpha beta. So this was a vector, four-dimensional vector, where mu goes from 0 to 3. And our goal was to actually try to understand these things and see what is the content. And to do that, I told you that you have to understand self-dual and anti-self-dual tensors, so two forms. And I introduced, I think the last thing I did was to introduce this object S mu alpha beta, which is constructed out of this guy, and this actually will make the dictionary between pairs of indices like this to two forms in space-time. Okay. Okay. So how do you do this? Well, imagine now that I have an object living here. So let's write it like V alpha beta. So you have an object like this. Then there are two things you can do. You can actually take the antisymmetric. So this is a tensor with two indices. So it will decompose into a symmetric part and its antisymmetric part. So let me write it like this. Okay. So notice that here we will have essentially one component, and here we will have three components. So here we have four components, and you have this. Okay, notice that this is 2 times 2. So actually, to extract the antisymmetric part, it's actually very easy to consider the following object, which I will call V, which is epsilon alpha beta, beta alpha beta. So this actually is a scalar, because I told you that this is a symplectic product, it's a SU2 invariant, so this is actually a scalar. You want a function. And now, so this is essentially extracting the antisymmetric part, because this is an antisymmetric tensor, so this is the one here, it turns out to be a scalar. And this guy here, I can actually now use this object, and this gives me actually an anti-self-dual form. So this is how you actually look at this tensor. So we are actually now, so we now know that if you start with the spinors, you take the tensor product of two different spinors, you get a vector. You take the same tensor product of the same left spinors, you get a scalar, an anti-self-dual form, and similarly, you can consider 1, 2, half R. So these are objects which are like this. And then, again, you will get a scalar, let me call it V, which is epsilon alpha beta, V alpha beta. And then you will get something that I can call, let me call this guy, just to make So let me call this V mu nu, which is this object here. And let me call this guy Vita bar mu nu, which is going to be, remember that I have another tensor sigma bar, which I introduced last time. So and this is a self-dual 2-4.
Marcos?
Yes.
Can I make a comment?
Sure.
When we teach quantum filter,
yes,
we have to explain what is the Dirac scalar.
Yes.
So we have to explain that the in Lorentz groove representation,
yes,
chiral 1,
yes,
1/2, comma 0,
yes,
and 0, comma 1/2,
yes,
for the Lorentz groove is the composition,
yes,
into a
solution. Yes.
And then there is a question, where is Maxwell field? So we explain now,
yes,
what is a Dirac.
Yes.
Dirac is 1/2 0 plus 0 1/2.
Yes.
So question is, where is the vector, the Maxwell field?
Yes.
So in spin 1, there are two cases.
Yes.
1/2 comma 1/2.
Yes.
Which totals spin 1.
Yes.
And that's a Maxwell field.
Yes.
And then there's what about the other guy, which is 1 comma 0?
Mm-hmm.
Because we,
yes,
can have 1 in the spin,
yes,
SU2 and 0 in the other one. Or 0, comma 1.
Yes.
And
this is 0, 1, yeah.
You just proved.
Yes, exactly.
That 1, comma 0
is a self-dual. Exactly.
And 0, comma 1
is an anti-self-dual. Absolutely, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because it's an obvious question, right?
Yes.
When you teach,
yes,
Lorentz group, what are,
absolutely,
the guys?
Yeah, 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 yeah. Absolutely.
You have to give names.
Yeah. Actually, I think this way, you know, it's not very complicated. And it's very explicit, because since you have these sigma matrices, you can do everything,
yeah,
here. I mean, if you are more familiar with kind of bundles, there is a kind of very, there's a kind of more fancy way of doing that, which is to consider the S plus bundle, so the spin bundle S plus, and the spin bundle S minus. So these are the spin bundles. And then, you know, it's what we're saying here in this notation is just that S plus times S minus is isomorphic to the bundle of one forms, and S plus times S plus, or actually let me just to keep notation, one forms, and S plus is 2 plus plus 2 0, and then this guy. So this is, if you want, the tensor. You are more familiar with, you like better bundles better than notation, this is the way to state it. This is a classical theory in spin geometry, okay? So of course, you know, in order to do that, you have to construct the spin bundles, and the spin bundles are essentially square roots of the tangent bundle. Huh? So, but this is topologically highly non-trivial. Right? You cannot always construct the spin bundles on a manifold and so on. There are abstractions to do this, topological abstractions. And when you have spin bundles, turns out that you can regard them as square roots of the tangent bundle, and this is actually why you have these sort of equalities here. But this is, well, these are called spin bundles. I cannot explain everything. So these are called spin bundles. You have never studied that. Yeah. Well, these are bundles. These are SU2 bundles over a manifold. Okay. So you have, so these are SU2 bundles over X.
Yeah, can you tell what is the fiber of this bundle?
Fiber of this bundle is a vector, is C2. So it's a C2 bundle. So this is in the fundamental representation. And actually, this is a section of that bundle, if you think about it, okay? So with fiber C2, and then absolutely, yeah, 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 absolutely. This is what I call SU2 left and SU2 right, absolutely. So constructing these bundles, as I say, is highly non-trivial because, you know, of course, on R4 or Minkowski space, you can always do it. But when you are considering a non-trivial manifold, then these bundles are not always defined. There are abstractions to this. Yes, Rina?
Are they isomorphic?
Which, sorry?
S plus minus, are they isomorphic?
Well, not really, because, you know, they give you different... The composition, they are locally isomorphic because they are both SU2 bundles, but globally they are not isomorphic because they lead you to this different, if you want, they are exchanged by, if you change the orientation of the manifold, you will exchange one with the other. But once you fix the orientation, you know they are different. Okay.
Within Minkowski, they would. Minkowski, if you just go Minkowski, then there is a parity transfer.
Yes. Parity. Yes. 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 But it says this is like changing the orientation of the manifold, right? So they are exchanged by the change of orientation, right? Okay, so actually when you look at this, then you know you can think as C alpha. Remember, this has two indices, so alpha 1, 2, and these are precisely the indices of SC2. It's a section of S plus, and C of S minus. I mean, that depends on your notation, okay? Actually, maybe I put it the other way around, sorry. So this is anti-self dual, so sorry. So with my notation, this is S minus and S plus, okay? Because I want this is anti-self dual, so this is here and this is self dual is here. Sorry.
Okay,
does it
matter? Yes.
Doesn't matter. Yeah, doesn't matter, it's just a question of convention, okay? Now, so this is kind of a very beautiful piece of four-dimensional geometry, which is actually crucial to all the, you want to understand, you know, the geometry of four manifolds. But now we're going to go to, so the goal, my kind of concrete goal for this was to actually show you that the abstract structure that we introduced last time about a transformation delta, which was a scalar, but at some time it was Grassmannian and so on, can be actually realized concretely, okay? So this is just some sort of preliminary geometric information. So now let's actually construct the delta symmetry that we were talking last time. And the way I'm going to do this is by operation which is called twist of supersymmetry. So what is supersymmetry? Well, supersymmetry is just it's a symmetry whose generators are Grassmannian. Grassmann odd. So this sense, this is something which is going to change to send a Grassmann even feeling, a Grassmann odd field. So usually you denote the generators of this transformation as Q alpha V and Q alpha dot V. So let me tell you the notation. So maybe you want to think about this as this. So this is a spinor. So it's this section of this bundle. So is actually an object like the one we saw before. So this means that, for example, if you act on a function with this, if you act on a function, say phi, you are going to actually produce an object which is a spinor. So it will give you something like S alpha V. Okay? So forget about the V index for a moment. So this is a transformation which takes a function into a spinor, for example. Or, you know, more generally, you can see that if you have a field with some given a spin, it will actually give you a field with different spins with a spin one half added by this index here, okay? Now V, yes?
What is V?
I'm going to explain now. Okay. I just was on the point of explaining it. V is just a index which goes round from 1 to 2. So this means that we have two different copies of this object, okay? So there will be Q alpha 1 and Q alpha 2, but actually these copies are non-trivial. There is what is called an internal symmetry. Which is yet another SU2, which is SU2R. So this means that actually these two objects, so Q alpha 1 and Q alpha 2, transform under SU2, okay? Okay. So there is a whole action of SU2 which rotates these two objects. And similar, there is an action of SU2 on this object, on this spinor here, that rotates these two objects. So this means that this is just a global symmetry of the series, what is called an internal global symmetry. And it's just a way of saying that you have two objects and these objects appear in such a way in their theory such that, you know, they always have SU2 invariants under this rotation, okay? So when you have, I mean, this is not the minimal supersymmetry. The minimal supersymmetry is just having one copy of this. But in order to do this operation I need to do, you actually need two copies of this, and this is what is sometimes called n equal two supersymmetry. N equal two just means that you have two copies of each of these guys. Okay? So you don't have, usually in a supersymmetry theory, you only need to have one of these charges, one of these and one of these. But in these theories, you have what is called standard supersymmetry, you have two copies. And this is going to be important in what follows, because with less supersymmetry, you cannot have this delta symmetry. Okay.
How many the maximum you can have is a four?
Yeah. Because, you know, you keep adding a spin, and if you want to have a spin less than two, in this theory, it's a spin less than one, in just Jan-Mills theories, you cannot have more than four supersymmetries. Okay, what I'm going to do now, again, I don't want to, and if you have never seen supersymmetry, the best way of seeing is to see how it acts on the fields. But again, I will keep on abstract, I want to keep the discussion a little bit abstract, because I just want to show you how, just by using this structure of supersymmetry, you will see how this delta symmetry that we introduced before appears in the game, okay? Now, what is the most important property of supersymmetry? Well, supersymmetry is a symmetry which you have to mix with Lorentz symmetry. Okay? And the basic property of supersymmetry, in the same way that the spin bundle is like a square root of the tangent bundle, the supersymmetry transformation is some sort of a square root of the momentum transformation. Okay? So translations has some sort of a square root symmetry, and this is supersymmetry. This means that if you do twice a supersymmetry transformation, you are going to do a translation in space-time. So this is actually very natural. You see, you have the tangent bundle. The tangent bundle is associated to translations, right? These are infinitesimal translations, right? The tangent bundle. Now, if there is a bundle which is a square root of the tangent bundle, you would expect to have some sort of a square root of the translations, and this is the supersymmetry. Okay. So that fits very well with this idea. Okay, so what is this property? Well, formally this property is the following. And notice these guys are Grassmann-Oz. Grassmann-Oz objects, typically, you have to produce anti-commutators, not just commutators. So the basic rule of these objects is that, I wrote this parenthesis here just to make sure that these are two copies of the same spinor, but I will drop out the parenthesis from now on. Huh? So now you know what these guys mean. So this has to be a square root of the translations. So what this can be? Well, if you have alpha and beta dot, this is the natural thing, that index that we put here in alpha beta dot. So again, we produce a vector index, and then we can contract this with the momentum. So this is as simple as this, you see? These two objects are the square of this guy is the momentum. And now we have here V and W, which are SU2 index. So we want an SU2 invariant tensor. And this is epsilon W. Where again, this is this totally antisymmetric tensor of SU2. This is the simplest basic fact that we are using, that SU2 has a totally antisymmetric tensor, which is this one. So this is the supersymmetry algebra. And this, again, is just expressing in more physical terms, the idea that tangent bundles have square roots. Now, as I said, you know, if you act with this with a field phi with these charges, you will get an object which has the index of this charge. So we have an index alpha and an index v. So there are fields that have index v, and now we want to see how from this algebra we can actually get something similar to what we have. And one of the things that we had, remember, was that T mu nu is delta of g mu nu. This is one of the things that we required. And in particular, by restricting this, we wanted to write p mu as delta g mu. So we wanted to write p mu as a mixing of two Grassmannian objects, which were delta and g. Okay. So this is exactly what we're going to do now. And the way to do this is to do something to this algebra, because as it stands, this algebra is not the same one that we have here. Here we needed a Grassmannian symmetry. Now we have a symmetry which is Grassmannian, but this was a scalar, while this is a spinorial. So how are we going to change this? This is the kind of the basic puzzle. So this looks very much like what we want, but we're still missing some of the ingredients. So the idea of solving this problem is what is called the twisting of the supersymmetry. Now, the twisting of the supersymmetry, I think this is due to Witten. Maybe somebody did it before, Samson. No, I think this time. Okay, so this was introduced by Witten. And then what Witten noticed is the following. Here, we have S due to R, and then we have two S due to L and S due to right. So, sorry, actually I'm mixing notation here. So let me call this S due to E. Sorry, this is, sorry, what? So, yeah, sorry, left and right and R symmetry, sorry. I should have called this plus and minus, okay? But let me call this SU2 internal, okay? Now, so there are three SU2s in the game. So what we then say is the following. Well, imagine that I just identify this SU2 internal with SU2 right, okay? So imagine that I... Well, I think in n equal 2, there are only two ways of doing it. In n equal 4, there are three. Yeah, in n equal 4, there are three. In n equal 2, there are just two, and they are essentially equivalent to a change of orientation. So in n equal 2, there is only one, essentially one way. Now, so the idea of Witek is, let's suppose that actually SU2i is equal to SU2R. So what this means, I mean, you know, this is just playing with the groups. How can I identify these two groups? Well, there is a way of doing this, which is, in physical terms, is what is called gauging an internal symmetry. So the way of doing this is the following. This guy transforms under two SU2s. This is the Lorentz SU2, and this is the internal SU2, okay? But I can declare this index to be also a spacetime index if I say, for example, that imagine that I have an object, imagine that I have a section of the bundle which has an index alpha and has an internal index v. Now, I can declare, how you see the fact that this guy has a Lorentz index related to alpha? Well, you can see it in covariant derivatives, okay? So you see the spin content in covariant derivatives. So you see, for example, in a covariant derivative, you will have d mu plus omega mu alpha, s mu, alpha beta c beta, so d mu delta alpha beta. So this is how you would construct a covariant derivative acting on this field, right? So this is the standard derivative, and this is the spin connection. Okay, but now I can declare that I can transform this field by now declaring that this covariant derivative is going to be the same that I was using here, mu s mu alpha beta. But now I can just add mu, and then out of this alpha, out of this index, I construct yet another, let me call it W, mu dW, and I declare this to be the new covariant derivative. So I couple, this index tells me that this object transforms under SU2, which is a global symmetry, and declare now that the way these things appear in my theory, as they couple to the spin connection, is not going to be the old one, but a new one in which I introduce yet another copy of the spin connection, coupling to the index in this way. Okay? So this is something that in physics you can do, which is you have a global symmetry, and you decide to gauge this global symmetry to make it local. And the way you do this in this case is just by declaring that the way covariant derivatives will act on this spinor is not the old one, but it's a new one in which you use the internal quantum numbers of this object to change the covariant derivative. So this is changing actually the dynamics of the theory, yes?
In the third term, is there something missing?
Sorry?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is again delta alpha beta. Huh? So if you want, I now here have delta dW, you're absolutely right. I'm going to write it more carefully. And then you have delta V beta, and then you have mu S mu V dW delta alpha beta acting on C beta W. So this produces an object with indexes B and alpha, okay? And this is how it goes.
Can you give another simple explanation?
Yes.
For R4? See, you know, it's for R4.
Yes.
What space does it matter?
Yes.
Okay. And easy explanation is like psi alpha nu.
Yes.
If for nu equals 1 is a column, and another column.
Mm-hmm.
So you get two.
Yes, absolutely.
Columns.
Yes.
The first column transforms under SU2.
Left. Yeah. SU2 right. Yeah.
SU2 Lorentz.
Yes.
And now if you look on the row, it forms another SE2, that SE2 internal.
Yes.
But what you have actually can be expanded as a vector.
Yes.
It is 2x2 matrix. You already explained that.
Yes,
2x2
absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
Can be thought of as a vector with that matrix.
Absolutely.
Signal.
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm going to do this kind of index reshuffling now. But I mean, it's important.
So,
But this is... But this is something that is not emphasized in the literature. Twisting means just adding to the change in the covariant derivatives of the fields, and this means that you are adding to the Lagrangian, a term which is just essentially the current of this internal symmetry times the spin connection. So essentially you have to change the Lagrangian by adding just the coupling, and that's why, for example, you have an anomalous global symmetry, you cannot use it for twisting, because then you inherit a local anomaly, and then the theory is sick. So that's why, you know, this is why the B model, for example, the topological B model, sigma model, cannot be only be defined on Calabi-Yau's, because the symmetry you use to do the twisting has a global anomaly in the case the manifold is not Calabi-Yau.
What about for fun?
Sorry?
For fun over.
Yeah, but this is the A model. The A model you can. But not the B model. The B model it just has an anomaly in the manifold not Calabi-Yau. So this is important that these symmetries should be anomaly free. Otherwise, you kill the theory. I mean, it's not a problem to have a global, an internal symmetry, a global symmetry with an anomaly is not a problem. But if you make this symmetry local, then you kill the theory if the current is anomalous. So this is important that we are using an internal symmetry to promote it to a local symmetry. So we are gauging this internal symmetry. So the symmetry becomes local now. When I mean local, means, you know, space-time independent. Now it's a.
If the space is flat.
Yes.
The Lagrangian is not changed.
Absolutely.
But you added your own current, so there is still.
Yeah, but the spin connection can be put to zero, right? If the space-time is flat, so.
Will be coupled.
Yeah.
There will be axion type coupling. SU2 internal.
Yes.
One current will be coupled to FF dual. Something like that. No?
Well, here in flat space there is no change at all. Just rename the because you can put always the spin connection.
Also
yeah, yeah. I mean, even if you have a, say, a torus, you are on a torus, you can do it. You can do it. On a torus, you can always put the spin connection to be zero. Okay, so this is how it comes. But in practice, what does it mean? In practice, it's very funny because this means, after doing this, essentially what happens is that I lose the internal symmetry, but I change the spins of all my fields. So in practice, every time we see an index V, we convert it in an index beta dot. Sorry. Yes, beta dot, okay? Or an index W. So now, let's see now what happens there. Now, we have this symmetry Q, which have these indices. Now, after this twisting, this becomes Q beta, and then I can call this, okay, let me call this alpha. Alpha and beta. So before I had here four components, as Samson was mentioning, I could think about this as having two components. Here had two types of indices. You have four components. Two were spacetime indices, and the other two were internal indices. But now I declare my internal indices to be also spacetime indices. So now I have a 4x4 matrix, and this decomposition goes through. So what I get from here? Well, I explain you the recipe here. Every time you have an object with two indices, this means that in space-time, you will have to decompose it into 3 plus 1. So I will get a scalar, and I call this Q. And I also get eta, and I get Q, let me call it Q mu nu, which is S mu nu. Alpha beta, or beta alpha beta. But this is the important thing. I got now a scalar, but Grassmannian odd charge. So this is exactly what I was looking for. I wanted something which is Grassmannian, and at the same time, it's a scalar. So this procedure gave me for free this object. Once I have the supersymmetry transformations, I can. And if I have enough internal symmetry, I can do this trick of Witten, and then I produce a scalar Grassmann odd symmetry. Okay,
it's
now.
Identical to what was done there,
but yeah,
it's scalar.
Absolutely.
And so the two spinners is the same
as
the scalar,
yeah,
and scalar.
So if I look here, let me get this thing here. So if I look here, I got delta. But how do I get mu, g mu? Well, actually, I also have another charge. I have q alpha v. And this goes to q alpha beta dot. But what is this? What is this in space-time? Just explain it there. This is a vector. So I can actually produce from this a vector, which I will call, so sigma, well, actually, you can put appropriate numbers here, but q gamma alpha. So out of this guy, you produce a vector. So let me just put equal, and then you can fix the coefficients later. So we got already essentially two nice things here. We got two Grassmannian symmetries. One of them is u mu, and the other is q. Okay. Now, notice that this relationship was telling me that p mu could be regarded as a sequence of transformations as the composition of delta and mu, which is essentially its anti-commutator, because this is the as we were explaining the other day, having this composition is like having the commutator and the anticommutator. But actually, this kind of relationship is the content of the supersymmetry algebra. And now it's a very easy exercise that I can propose you here. It's a very easy exercise to see.
Combination of the supersymmetry.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So that's the great thing. This thing that, you know. So this actually says that, you know, the content of this actually was essentially that, you know, if a theory is topological, nothing can depend on the location you are, right? So this relation is telling you that changing the location of something in your theory is going to be trivial, because it's delta of something, essentially, right? So a topological theory, you need this property that as you change the location of things, things do not change. And supersymmetry was already known to have this property thanks to this property here. For example, people knew that in many situations in supersymmetric theories, you were computing something, some operator located at a point, changing the location of the point at which you compute your operator didn't change the calculation, precisely because this thing here. So supersymmetric theories have already some sort of topological character, precisely because translations can be trivialized by this relationship. And this is actually what you formalize here. So now let me just indicate you that now it's actually very easy to see from that relation there. You can actually see. So if I define g mu and q bar in this way, you actually can see that q bar g mu is essentially proportional to p mu. So this is an easy exercise, and what you have to do, the only thing you have to do to use is that trace of c bar nu beta, so trace of c bar nu is delta mu nu. This is the only thing you have to use. This is an exercise I propose you. Start with that anti-commutation relation. Using this, prove that this is the case. Okay. So just from the supersymmetry algebra, we see already that a weak version of this stronger statement is already valid without doing anything, just by using the basic anti-commutation relationships of the algebra. Okay. Now, another thing you can show in this simpler version of the algebra is that Q squared is equal to zero. Okay. That's, well, in order to see this, you have to use another, anti-commutator of the symmetry algebra. So this doesn't follow from that one, but it follows from the anti-commutator of Q's in the symmetry algebra, of the supersymmetry algebra. So let me actually write it down for you, this anti-commutator. So that,
maybe you just for generality, yes. Use central charges also.
Yeah, I could actually do that, but so this just follows from the fact that Q alpha B Q beta B is equal to zero, already you get this thing here. So this is the main discovery of Witten, was then that if you have the supersymmetry algebra, most of the, after doing these changes of indexes, you get essentially all the requirements for a topological field theory. Okay, it's just as the level of abstract transformations. So now sometimes, as Samson is pointing out, sometimes the supersymmetry algebra has what is called central charges. So this means that this, the composition of two supersymmetries is the momentum plus a global symmetry of the theory. In this case, Q squared is not zero, but it is this covariant derivative. Okay, but this also follows from the supersymmetry algebra. And what I'm going to do is, when I discuss Donaldson-Witten theory, I will write some of the transformations, and you will see how Q squares to a Gauss transformation. That's very easy. Okay. Okay. So the main message of this until now is that you have a topological field theory is a very strange object. It's a very strange object because, you know, it has these properties that the energy momentum tensor has a vacuum expectation value of average equal to zero because of these underlying relationships. And this is very hard to realize in a standard quantum field theory. But now we have seen that if you have a supersymmetry, a quantum field theory with some supersymmetry structure behind, then automatically you will have some of the requirements of topological field theory already implemented, just by virtue of the supersymmetry algebra. Okay? So now what I want to do is to introduce a concrete Gauss theory which actually implements this, and probably this will end up my time. So let's now then, maybe I have now a couple of minutes, introduce some ingredients of Gauss theory for manifold, and then we can explain the Donaldson-Witten theory. So let's see. So what do we want now? So let me first start with some kind of general things about Gauss theories and four manifolds. Okay. So now I assume X to be a four-dimensional manifold, and I want to do Gauss theory on it. So this means that I will have to consider a principal bundle over X, so with a Lie group. So you can think, for example, of G as, if you want to do SU2 Gauss theory, of SUN Gauss theory, you can think about SUN or SU2. And given a representation of rho, representation of G, you can actually form an associated vector bundle, okay, over X. So this is the associated vector bundle. So for example, you have SU2, and rho is the fundamental representation. This is a rank 2 vector bundle over X, okay? Now, the basic ingredient we will need here is, of course, is the connection. Connection on P or on E. And actually, the most economical way of describing these things is by using local patches. So on a local patch U alpha, local patch of the manifold, A mu, so A, the connection A, is a one form with values in the Lie algebra of G, which I'm going to denote by G. And then the question, of course, when you do local patches is how you actually change from patch to patch. So if you are in the intersection of the two patches, you will have A, let me write it in components, A mu alpha can be written, well, I have this, yes, or A mu beta. I mean, or if you don't want indices, it's going to be G alpha beta minus 1, A alpha, G alpha beta plus I, d alpha beta minus 1 d e alpha beta, where e alpha beta are the transition functions which takes values on the Lie algebra G. Okay, sorry, on G. Okay. Okay. So these are the transition functions associated to the principal under key. Okay. So this is how I define this. So this is the kind of the easier way of describing these connections is in this way. And the curvature of the bundle
maybe it's good to
stop. Yes.
We physicists like to put the mathematicians. So the mathematicians want to write B plus A, and we write B plus IA.
Absolutely. Yeah. That depends on your choice of Hermitian versus anti-Hermitian. Right. Absolutely. So my convention here, I guess, is Hermitian. Anti-Hermitian? Hermitian, I think. Yeah. I think the convention here is that G are Hermitian, so the Lie algebra so essentially I think that just the only thing I'm saying is that, you know, an element of the Lie algebra is going to be written, an element of the Lie group is E times phi, where phi is an element of the Lie algebra. So I have an I here and this gets propagated here. Okay, I guess that's my. Okay, maybe I can stop now and leave some 15 minutes. So also given, given a connection, we can define its curvature. And in local coordinates, this is just given by d a alpha plus I a alpha wedge a alpha. So it's a two form. But it satisfies the property that in changing, if you change trivialization, then it changes in an easier way. Sorry, f alpha. So it just changes by the adjoint action. So this is the adjoint action. Adjoint action of G. So this is a two form with values in a Lie algebra, which is when you change the trivialization, it changes like this. And forms of this type are called the omega start section of the adjoint bundle. You can think of the adjoint bundle. So you can think of the adjoint bundle as the as an associated vector bundle to the principal bundle, in which you take as your vector bundle the Lie algebra, and you add with the adjoint action on the Lie algebra. Okay, so in particular the connection is an element of 2G. Okay. And in coordinates, in local coordinates, it's very easy. You just describe this as a two form on each patch, and when changed from patch to patch, the rule of transformation from one patch to the other is joined by the adjoint action of the transition functions, which are associated to P. Okay. So I mean, this is in a sense too sophisticated for a physicist. We just want to think about A's as just one forms, and this is just a local gauge transformation. So, speaking of what, you have to also to introduce the gauge transformations into the game. So, gauge transformations again, you can define it locally. It's better defined locally as a set of functions on each set on G. So they are very similar to the transition functions. And they act, let me write it like this, they act on the gauge on the connection, essentially in the same way, sorry, U alpha, also by the adjoint representation, and then you have also this extra term, U alpha minus 1. So this is how they act on fields, and on the gauge connection they also act in the same way. So in the same way as the trivial U alpha minus 1. Okay. Okay. So this is my basics of gauge connections. Let me just point out something. If you have two gauge connections, because we, at some point we like to think in terms of the space of all gauge connections, you have two gauge connections and you take the difference, you can see that when you take the difference of two gauge connections and you transform, you see how they transform under a change of paths, this term drops. And then it turns out that this guy belongs to the omega 1 GE, because it's a one form which under change of trivialization changes with this, so it's exactly how the curvature transforms, but this is not a two form, it's a one form, so it's an element in omega 1 of G, okay? So this is going to, sorry, G, sorry, let me just call it G.
No, that's not good. You have G associated to the Lie algebra.
Yes. We twist it? When? Where do I twist it?
Okay, so this is the one,
yes,
which is the product of P and G.
I don't understand. So okay, so this is a bundle and this is the Lie algebra, right? This is what is coming. Okay. Okay, so maybe just let me call it, I don't know how you can. G E is okay? G E is E, okay, sorry. So this is the standard, yeah, you are right. Well, you know, I have to denote it in some way, right?
GP.
GV.
P is better.
P is fine.
P, GP. Okay, GP. Sorry. GP, yes.
Here is GP, right?
Yeah, this is GP, yes. Is that, that's okay now?
Can you remind what is globally gauge transformation?
Sorry?
What is gauge transformation globally?
Globally, it's a section. So let's see. So globally, it's a section of the. It's an automorphism of the principal bundle P. Okay, you can think about this as a global automorphism of P, and then this is the local expression you have. Okay. So it's an automorphism of the principal bundle. Yeah. Absolutely. Right.
And sections also.
Yes. So I guess this is everything I need. This is something I will need later on, because this is telling you that this is telling you something about infinitesimal deformation of the connection. I will use it later. So, but now let me actually come back to the more physics size point of view. So now I want to have. So let's now introduce finally this Donaldson Witten theory. Okay. Now, in order to start with this, let me just, so we want a quantum field theory based on connections, gauge connections. So So I will use the same setting here, but I will usually, so I will always write the gauge condition when I'm using this physics language. I will always use this component condition. I will drop the local. I assume that I'm always working on a local trivialization, so I'm using this formalism here, but I will drop the index, okay, as it's usually in physics. Now, what I want to do now is to construct a theory based on that, and it turns out that the theory based on that has an axiom which is given by integral. So in components, so you write it in, so f is the curvature. Sorry?
A mu dx mu. A is a one form.
Oh, okay.
Better.
Yeah, so curvature form. So this is the axiom functional. It's an axiom functional for a gauge connection. So you give me a gauge connection of your manifold, and then I compute f, which is star of f. This, notice that since I take in the trace, this is globally well defined, because I'm going from patch to patch and using this thing, and you can see that in any product like this, this drops. So this is actually a function. It's well defined over the whole manifold, and I can integrate it. Okay, it's a two-form, which is well defined over the whole manifold, and I can integrate it, and this gives me the action functional of Jahn-Mills. Now, if you write this in components, then this is trace of f mu nu, okay? Where actually I'm using the metric to raise indices, okay? And then I have this square root of g. Sorry, let me write it, the volume form. So let me write it like this. Trace. Okay, so one natural question, this is a question that was asked by physicists in the 70s, it's a very nice story, is how do you minimize this action? What are the connections that minimize this action? So you want to, because you know the principle of least action tells you that, you know, you should look for configurations that minimize this action. And actually, when you do that, one way to do that actually is to use this very beautiful decomposition we were using before in terms of dual and anti-self-dual parts of the connection. Okay, so let me actually write it here. So notice that the Jahn-Mills action, it's very different from another quantity that I can consider, which is this thing here, okay? If here I put the Hodge dual in front of f, here I don't. But this actual object, actually, it's a characteristic class and actually it's quantized. So k is an integer, and this is called the instanton number. Of course, the instanton number, if you are familiar with gauge theories and for manifolds, just the integrated characteristic class.
Well, there have been lectures here by Panin.
Oh,
this is called C2 minus 1 half C1 squared.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
But one nice, actually the decomposition in F plus minus is actually very useful to understand what are the configurations that minimize this action. So let me write it like this. So let me call this S Jahn-Mills. Yes? Yes, yes, everything is Euclidean. Everything is always Euclidean here. Now, I can write now this as maybe up to some factors. F plus times with plus maybe up to some overall factor of 1/2 or something like that, plus trace of F minus. Sorry? Yeah, because these are just let me write it like this, because this is definite, this is positive definite, right? If I write it like this. No, but this is positive definite because this is F mu nu plus F mu nu plus. Well, if without the star, it's not obvious that this is positive definite. I want to use the inner product on the space of forms.
Star F plus.
Absolutely, it's plus F plus and the star of minus F minus is minus. Yeah, but I write it in this way to make sure that these two things are both positive definite, okay? Now, this is interesting because this object here, trace of plus trace of F, which F is actually trace of F plus times F plus minus integral of trace minus plus F minus. Okay? So I can write the axiom of Supergian-Mills as the integral of trace F plus times star of F plus. Here I'm using as so that by definition of self-duality. And then minus trace integral trace F which F. So here you see, what I'm doing is very silly. I'm just, here I have these terms, but I can write this term in terms of this guy minus this guy. So eventually I write super Jan-Mills, the Jan-Mills action as this term, which is positive definite, plus ontological invariant, minus ontological invariant. I mean, I'm just, but then there is another factor there, which is actually the same. When you do all the factors, which I did it actually with the local, you can see that, you know, the relative factor is just one. Okay. I think so. Yeah, so, yeah, I mean, here I'm not putting overall factors because there are 1/4 and 1/2 depending on how you define this. So usually, if you are careful about factors, you should put a 1/4 here. This is the standard one. And then, you know, you will have these factors here. Now, So maybe I want to, okay, yeah, you're right. So I should put a 2-factor 2 there. Okay, so just let me make sure. Yes. Yes, okay. So now imagine that you want to minimize this object in the class of fields which have, so now we want to minimize this. In the class of connections, we fix k positive, okay? Now, I'm choosing k positive because if I choose k negative, I have to write this with f minus instead, okay? So now let's assume that the k is fixed and is positive. Now, if k is fixed is positive, what you have here is something which is definite positive, minus plus something positive here. So the way to minimize this is to make this as small as possible. This is positive definite. The only way to make it minimal is to take f plus equal to 0. So you will see how this is consistent with my choice of signs. When I do that, what I get minimization imposes, actually this is a minus of my conventions, imposes F plus is equal to 0. Okay. Now if F plus is equal to 0, then you see that this is negative, and this is negative, then this is negative because it's minus something which is positive definite. So since this is this is minus I pi square k with my conventions, then you see that k is positive and it's consistent. If I do it the other way around, if I choose k minus, it's very easy to see the minimization condition is f minus equal to 0.
Okay. This formula shows that the Hessian Mills is bounded below
exactly
by absolute value of k.
Absolutely,
and
absolutely.
You achieve the bound.
Yes.
By f plus equals 0 or f minus.
But notice how easy is this by using this self-duality story. By decomposing f into f plus plus minus, I get this almost trivially. Okay. And the minimization now you can see that this is a nice condition. Which actually gives, this is a special set of connections. Only a special set of connections will satisfy that f plus is equal to 0. And these are called instantons. So this is actually a story which is very important. It was actually discovered by Russian physicists. So, and the other day, Samson was telling me all the intense activity that was developed in St. Petersburg some years ago, quite some time ago, around the instantons. Yeah.
The good point to say is that you have to add the action to be finite.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. So, with finite action, absolutely. Actually, this is a very important point. I mean, sometimes you can find configurations which are extremes of the action, but are not do not have the finite action.
Full
length
is not compact.
Sorry?
Full length is not
yeah, yeah. For example, it's not clear. For example, that the vacuum of QCD, the true vacuum of Jan Mills' theory on R4, is clearly probably not a configuration of finite action. No? So.
Excuse me.
What I mean is that this action has to be finite. I want this to minimize.
It doesn't go to infinity.
Exactly, or to minus infinity. Because I'm minimizing this, you know, could have, this is positive definite as long as, you know, this field is smooth. But if you consider fields with singularities, this could explode and you could make this as negative as you want, okay? So in the realm of a smooth configurations with finite actions, this is the minimization criterion is this f plus equal to 0, okay? Now, this actually plays a very important role in what follows. And now what I want to do is to construct a physical theory in which this requirement is actually defining the space of configurations that will contribute, okay? So, but this is very important. In any theory with a gauge connection and with Jan Mills action, you will have these configurations as important configurations which minimize the action with finite action. Okay, so now we are going to consider now a very special gauge theory. So when I mean a gauge theory, it's a theory based on gauge connections on a manifold in such a way that the action for the gauge field involves this Jan Mills action. Now, I want to have a topological theory, so I will require this theory to have to be supersymmetric. And this is what is called sometimes n equal to super Jan Mills theory. So what is this theory? What is the field content of this theory? Well, it's a gauge theory, so it will have a gauge connection, A mu. And now we will have also two spinors, okay? That I will write lambda alpha v, lambda alpha dot v. And this v is an index going from 1 and 2. And these fields actually transform under the fundamental representation of SU2. So there is an internal SU2 symmetry, SU2i. So there is a doublet. There are two spinors for each value of v. There are two values of v, and for each value of v, there is a spinor, and the same one here. And on top of that, there is a complex scalar field. And they are all in the adjoint representation. So this means that under a change of trivialization, they transform like the, I just erased it, they transform like the gauge, they transform like the curvature. They transform in this way. When physicists say that fields are in the adjoint representation, they say that under a change of trivialization, they all take values on this bundle, and they transform under a change of trivialization like this. So you should think about this. Well, this is the gauge connection. So this is what we described before. This is a complex scalar, so it's a complex zero form with values in the adjoint representation. So if you want phi, and then these guys, lambda, alpha v, this I would call it maybe S minus g of p, and L bar, it's they transform in this way. Okay, so they are all fields in the adjoint representation. So this is the field content, and now you want to know what is the action principle for these fields. So you want to write the action for these fields. Well, this is it's a long action. You can find it in the notes that I gave for this lecture. I won't write it all in the blackboard. But the important thing, there are many ingredients here, but the kinetic terms, what are called the kinetics of the Lagrangian, are the standard ones. So the action, it's so let me write it in the physicist way. Then you have, well, a global trace. I take a trace because everything here, I want to have a globally well-defined function. And this, when you have fields changing, transforming in the adjoint representation, the easier way is to take a trace. It's going to make it this global. So I have 1/4 mu nu f mu nu. And then I will have mu dagger mu phi. And then I will have the standard Dirac term for the lambdas plus some other stuff. Okay, you can see the whole thing there, but notice that this is the standard Jan-Mills action that I wrote before. This is the standard action for a scalar, complex scalar field, and this is the covariant derivative with respect to the gauge connection. So this is d mu plus i mu dot. And here, again, is the covariant derivative. So these guys are in the adjoint representation. So they are what they're called charged under the gauge field. So this is the covariant derivative. But since these are fermions, these are spinors, they also involve the spin connection of the Forman. Okay? So plus spin connection. Of course, the scalars by definition do not couple to the spin connection. So if they have fields, I put here the spin connection term that corresponds to the spin of the fields. Now this action it's very complicated. You can think that this is much more complicated than a simple Jahn-Mills action, which I just have as a gauge connection. So what I put all this stuff, where I putting all this stuff, because I want to have supersymmetry, and I want to have a supersymmetry, an extended supersymmetry as I had before. So I want to have these charges Q alpha dot V Q alpha V. And now it's very easy to see what I was telling you before, and you know it's very, I think it's nicer to understand now when concrete ingredients here. Now we can see that these charges are neath all this field content, because this is a supersymmetry, means that you have to exchange, when you act on a field you will have to produce another field, and at the end of the day you need a finite number of fields, so the supersymmetry has to lead to a finite number of fields, but clearly you cannot just have one single gauge connection. You have to have fermions. So this means, for example, that if you act with Q alpha beta on A mu, you need to have something. You cannot just have zero. Huh? And what do you have? Well, that's why I introduced these fields here, because I want to have these fields. And now, notice that this is going to be lambda, actually, beta. So I need, since I have here an index v, I need to have an index v somewhere here. And this is a vector. So how do I get from a vector to a tensor? Well, it's very easy. That's why I have all these sigma mu's here, right? I have sigma mu, alpha, beta dot. So you see, I have an index alpha here, I have an index mu here. But sigma mu allows me to go from these two indices to a third index here. So this is the supersymmetry transformation of the gauge connection. So that's why in supersymmetry you cannot just have just the gauge connection. You need tons of other fields. And, well, you can actually write all these transformations, but in the notes that I gave for the school, they are listed in detail. This is the kind of boring part of supersymmetry. You have to write all these transformations, and it's a little bit boring, but for example, notice that if I act, a very simple transformation rule is the following. What do you get if you add with Q on phi? What would you get? Phi is a scalar, and acting with a spinor. So a spinor acting on a scalar gives me a spinor. Which spinor do you get? Well, of course, you get these ones. So you add on phi, you get actually lambda alpha v, okay? So this is a very easy rule. And you can actually cook up all these transformations, and you have to, you can actually verify that the algebra that I was writing you before, the Q with Q bar, produces a momentum operator, and in this case, actually, it produces something else, which is a gauge transformation. So in general, Q bar, let me just write it formally, is going to be P mu plus gauge transformation. But that's fine, because a gauge transformation with U alpha is equal to the EI phi, where phi is the field. So phi is this field here, which lives in the Lie algebra, okay? Takes values in the Lie algebra. So you can use phi. Phi is a complex scalar which lives in the Lie algebra, so you can use it to actually generate a complexified gauge transformation. Okay, so this is the theory. It's a very complicated theory. It's called n equal to super Jahn-Mills. It's a quite complicated theory, but the nice thing about it is that now that we know how to produce a topological field theory from a supersymmetric theory, we can use this particular realization of n equal to supersymmetry to produce a topological field theory, okay? And you will see that how things fit very nicely into the mathematical description of instantons on a form animal. So let me, probably this is the last thing I will be able to do, but I should write it here. So how does it work, the twisting of this theory? Now we have supersymmetric theory, and as I was advertising in the first part of this talk, with you can actually produce a topological field theory by twisting supersymmetry. So let's now twist the supersymmetry. So the twist of supersymmetry, remember, was very easy. You have to promote V to an index beta dot. Now, once you do that, of course, these guys will give you these transformations that you needed. But you also have to see how this changes the fields that you have in the theory. Okay? So what happens to these fields when you do this twisting? Well, A mu doesn't change. In the twisted theory, you still have a gauge connection. Now, how this changes? Well, lambda alpha v becomes lambda alpha beta. But what is this? This is a vector. So with this, I can produce a field, let me call it psi mu, which is sigma mu alpha beta times lambda alpha beta. So notice again, this is a Grassmannian variable in the original theory. Not I got a Grassmannian variable, but with values which is a one form. You can think about this as a vector, or you want to, or also as the components of a one form. Now they have lambda alpha dot v goes into lambda alpha dot v dot. But we know that this will produce two objects for us. One is just the trace, the antisymmetric combination. And this guy, I call it eta, which is a complex, it's a scalar, but Grassmannian. And now I got, if you want, g mu nu, which is this symmetric combination, so it's s mu nu alpha beta times lambda alpha beta. So I get a Grassmannian object, which is a two-form, a self-dual two-form. Okay? So that's and then I still have phi. Phi doesn't touch, because phi is just a scalar, doesn't change, it is not charged under V, it has no V index, so it doesn't change. Notice that if phi has a V index, it would become a spinor. And that's actually how you produce this theory called Cyber-Witten theory, which I don't have time to explain here. But actually, Cyber-Witten theory involves a spinor, and this spinor is actually a scalar which has been twisted. If I have an index here, V, this will become a spinor. Okay? But this is not the case here. Okay? So notice something very interesting. My original theory was not defined on any four manifold, because as I mentioned before, if you have a standard theory with spinors and you want to put it on a four manifold, you have an obstruction. If you want to put a quantum field theory on a manifold, every field should become the section of a bundle. Okay? Now, the bundle of forms, differential forms, is well defined on any if you have a principal bundle which defines the gauge connection, but then all the other fields will follow. Okay? So for example, phi is well defined on any four manifold because this is a section of this bundle. But now these guys are only defined if the spin bundle is well defined, which is not the case for any four manifold. Not any four manifold has spin bundles which are well defined. There's an abstraction to do this, which is called the Stiefel-Whitney class. So the Stiefel-Whitney class of the four manifold is non-zero. You cannot just have spinors on this manifold. Okay? This is, people working on general relativity have devoted a lot of time to this because, No, it's clear that our universe must be a four manifold which is a spin because we see spinors around. So we live in a spin manifold. But, there are manifolds which are not a spin.
Excuse me, am I right to understand what you mean is that you want to have a spin action on the bundle which should be compatible with the vector, with associated vector bundle?
I just saying something even simpler. If you want to define the spin bundles, you cannot always do it. You cannot always do it. You have to construct a spin bundle, and any spin bundle is okay, but in some manifolds you just don't have them, right? So the spin bundle, there is something called a spin C bundle in any four manifold, but this is slightly different, okay? But what I want to mention here is that once you do the twisting, your theory is well defined. Because you see, now my theory always only involves forms. I started with the spinors, but now I have only forms. I have psi mu, which is a one form, so psi mu lives in here. This guy lives in 0 dp, and this guy lives in 2 plus p. So all these bundles are well defined. So even in my original theory is not well defined, these objects are well defined. So this is actually how you can make sense of this theory on any four manifold. In any four manifold, the twisted theory is well defined. Even if the original supersymmetric Jamming theory was not well defined, the twisted theory will be well defined. So I can just define it like this. Okay, now, what's the interest of this theory? What is this theory describing? I don't have the time to tell you what is this theory doing exactly, but this theory turns out to be deeply related to the space of instantons. So the instantons are configurations that satisfy f plus equal to 0, and this theory turns out to describe essentially the integration of differential forms on the space of instantons, okay? So I don't think I will have the time to do this because I have just 2 minutes left, right? But maybe 5 minutes. So just let me mention something which is interesting, because it turns out that these three fields that appear here have a very nice interpretation when you describe the moduli space of instantons. So, and this is actually shows you how this theory is actually deeply related to the moduli space of instantons. So let's imagine that you want to describe the space of instantons at least infinitesimally, okay? So you want to construct so local description of the moduli space of instantons. This is actually a very nice thing. So start with an connection which solves the instanton equation, f plus a equal to 0. And now, consider an infinitesimal perturbation which also satisfies. So this is a perturbation of a, so this is a different connection, a prime, which is a plus a infinitesimal. Now notice that a lives in omega 1 of gp, because I told you before that the difference of two connections transforms under the adjoint representation, so a is there. Now I want this equation to be true, and if you actually do an infinitesimal expansion of this, you see that the first term is this one, and then the second term is the projection onto the self-dual part, if you want. This is the, when you expand this condition, you get something like this. So this is zero by definition, and this, the first order vanishing, means that omega A, so this is the covariant derivative, so this is the Gauss covariant derivative that I wrote before, that thing here, is equal to zero. So infinitesimal deformations of an instanton are one forms such that their covariant derivative plus is equal to zero. But of course, you know, here we have Gauss symmetry. Any two connections which differ in a Gauss symmetry are to be regarded as equivalent. So if A minus A prime is a Gauss transformation, an infinitesimal Gauss transformation, because A is an infinitesimal thing, then A minus A prime, A is equivalent to A prime. So when you consider the space of infinitesimal Gauss transformations, you have A lives in omega 1. But the condition of this is actually a condition in omega 2 plus dp, and actually you want this to be zero. And two gauge transformations differ, two connections that differ in a gauge transformation are regarded as trivial, and this phi has to live in omega 0 g of p. So notice that we have here omega 1, omega 0, or omega 2 plus. These are the ingredients to construct this modular space, and these are exactly this set of fermions that appear here in the theory. I mean, you can actually make this slightly more precise. I don't have the time to do it, but notice that the fermions that appear in this theory, the twisted spinor fields that appear in this theory are exactly the ones that appear naturally when you study the modular space of instantons. And actually, if you actually make this more concrete, you actually see that this action describes the right integration form for the modular space of instantons. Okay. But I don't have the time to explain in more detail. You can actually read my notes, but this is explaining a little bit more detail. So let me stop here. Yeah.
Thank you very much.